Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. His Royal Highness is nearly here. Can I please ask you to stand as he comes in? So if you could stand up now, please. Oh, there you go. Yeah. Thank you, Rosalind. Get that phone out of the way. Yeah, he's just talking on his way in. That's cool. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales. Thank you. Please welcome the Acting Vice Chancellor of Lincoln University, Professor Bruce McKenzie. Thank you.
Your Royal Highness, good afternoon and welcome to Lincoln University. Welcome also to our many distinguished guests who are here, council members, staff, students, alumni, and members of the wider Lincoln University family. I'd also like to make a warm welcome to everyone here who is concerned with the ultimate issue of our time, the state of the environment and its future. First of all, sir, I am truly delighted that you arrived safely without any student pranks. Now, the reason that I say that is 46 years ago, your father, Prince Philip, he visited Lincoln University, and with prior approval, he was intercepted at the gates by a group of our students who brought him onto campus sitting on a hay bale, on a hay wagon that was pulled by a tractor. And we do have some photographs to show you of that, sir. Now, today, Lincoln University is honored to provide the venue for your keynote address. We hope that our own mana in the field of environmental stewardship will support the impact of your words. Sir, I know that you are president of the Royal Agricultural University at Cirencester, and through that role you share a particular alignment with Lincoln University because historically we originated as a Cirencester agricultural facility in the Southern Hemisphere. Our principal building, Ivy Hall, which is off to the side there, is partly modeled on Cirencester, and our founding director, William Edward Ivy, was a graduate of Cirencester. After Cirencester, established in 1845, Canada's Ontario School of Agriculture, founded in 1874, Lincoln began in 1878, and therefore is the third oldest agricultural teaching university in the world and the oldest in the Southern Hemisphere. When I say that today Lincoln University is a land-based university concerned with the environment and with nature, with a capital N, I know you will identify with what I am saying. The environment and sustainability are important to us all for the reasons that you have written about and spoken about many times in the past. Nature and the health of the whole complex web of interconnected life, as you have called it, is fundamental to our very survival as human beings. It is as critically important as that. Sir, we will listen to your words with close attention. Ladies and gentlemen, His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales. Please, sir.
Senator Tokotoa. Ladies and gentlemen, Acting Vice Chancellor, I'm enormously touched that you should have asked me to speak here today, and most grateful for this opportunity to visit Lincoln University, an institution I have long admired from afar. And I do apologize for keeping you all waiting for an inordinate amount of time, but I rather knew when I looked at the program this morning that this was bound to happen. So I do apologize. I don't think what I'm going to say is going to be nearly good enough to make the wait worthwhile. But anyway, that I have been invited here today to offer a few of my own observations about the state of the global environment is a particular honor for me. But more than this, I fear it is a rather worrying indication of just how devastatingly serious the situation has become. It is not simply the case that we face an urgent global crisis, in fact, a climate and biodiversity emergency that has been clear for some time, as many of us have been trying to save for years, and as the long-delayed groundswell of global public concern and frustration now reflects. We have, I'm afraid, reached a defining moment in human history, a tipping point at which we still have the ability to change course, but really only in the next 10 years. So a very small window after which there may be no going back. For instance, today, about 15 to 17% of the Amazon has been deforested. Should that figure reach 20 to 25%, which at current rates of deforestation is only 20 to 30 years away, the effects on the world's climate system will be utterly dire. This is science, not conjecture or scaremongering, or some kind of plot to undermine the economic system as we know it. The tragedy of our recent past, it seems to me, is that we have come to view human achievement in terms of our ability to defeat nature, to defy the limitations she imposes on us, and to demonstrate our own supremacy as a species over the natural economy she requires. We have abused and desecrated nature. We have ruthlessly exploited her and given nothing back in return, and simply forgotten or denied that we are all part of an interlinked system without which we cannot survive. Having sown these seeds of disregard for nature, where literally nothing is sacred anymore, we are now reaping a blighted harvest of the alarming loss of biodiversity and of the ever more evident, frightening impacts of climate change. Indeed, if we were to think about nature and our assets as humanity's own bank account, it is clear that we have been on a dizzying spending spree for centuries. We now find ourselves dangerously overdrawn and urgently need to figure out how we are going to repay the mounting debt. And, ladies and gentlemen, if we were to think of this planet as a patient, any self-respecting doctor would long ago have made a precautionary intervention on the basis of the symptoms displayed. We are feeling the effects of all this now, of course, and natural disasters are increasing with terrifying frequency and intensity, and causing unprecedented levels of physical and economic damage. New Zealand is already seeing higher temperatures, more serious flooding, droughts, increased sea level rise, and warmer and more acidic oceans. In many ways, New Zealand's backyard, the Pacific, is the front line in this struggle. For small island nations, such as Tuvalu, Tokelau, or Kiribati, this is an existential crisis which could see them quite literally disappear or become uninhabitable in the lifetime of our grandchildren. But no nation, no region, and no population will be inured from the impacts of food, water, and energy insecurity, and the resulting economic and political insecurity that arise from our seeming utter determination, quite literally, to test this planet to destruction, as if we were conducting a scientific experiment. Now, in all of this, we could do well, as I have attempted to urge on frequent occasions, to recall the belief of many indigenous peoples around the world that in making decisions, we should think about the consequences for unborn children, 7 generations in the future. If we had followed their example, we might not face the situation that now confronts us. But there is still just time, but only just, to take that longer view and to secure the future for those who will follow us. In so doing, it would be worth bearing in mind the Maori principle of Kaitiakitanga, which holds that we are intrinsically connected to the natural environment and that it is beholden on us to treat it with care, guardianship, and good management. If, ladies and gentlemen, we can find a place for this traditional wisdom at the heart of a new decarbonized and circular bioeconomy, if we can turn back to nature with reverence and respect and recognize that we are utterly dependent upon her, and if we realize that our economy must be informed by nature's own waste-free circular economy, then we still can change course. That is why, faced as we are with seemingly insurmountable challenges, we are also surrounded by unprecedented opportunity. To seize that opportunity will require bold and imaginative action on a radically different trajectory. As Albert Einstein said, we cannot solve our problems with the same thinking we use to create them. In many ways, public opinion, the technologies, the nature-based solutions, and crucially, as I will say today, the finance, are all there and waiting to be scaled up. The solutions do exist. The crucial question is whether we can bring people, governments, and markets together to focus on those that will make the very great difference we need in the very little time that we have. Addressing this crisis is a challenge to which we all must rise. And we can, by doing just as New Zealand is doing, and taking ambitious action on mitigation and adaptation at home, whilst promoting transparent, credible, and ambitious action overseas. New Zealand is offering vital leadership in this regard, with a climate change program that includes a target of taking responsibility for reducing emissions by 11% below 1990 levels by 2030, and a zero carbon bill, which will set an emissions reduction target of net zero carbon emissions by 2050. In every sector of the economy, there are solutions available now, which can move us onto a trajectory of decarbonization and genuine sustainability, if given the right incentives that could be redirected from the current perverse ones that are so damaging the planet. How we grow our food is perhaps the most critical and yet easily resolved problem. Industrialized agriculture, as opposed to extensive agroecological farming, is responsible for around a fifth of global greenhouse gas emissions and is the biggest single contributor to biodiversity loss, including the overwhelming proportion of tropical deforestation, either for beef or commodities such as soy and palm oil, which, as you all know so well, are grown in vast monocultural plantations that are a classic example of how we unnecessarily desecrate nature instead of working in harmony with her. At the same time, we have totally ignored the health and fertility of the soil for far too long by relying on artificial fertilizer made from fossil fuel, and so face declining yields from degraded land, just as we face a remorselessly rising global population. All this means that we have to change radically our farming practices. Now, I know only too well that this is a difficult issue in many places, not least in New Zealand, where farmers will be understandably nervous about radical change. But here, as elsewhere, business as usual is simply not an option. Instead, New Zealand's commitment to becoming the most sustainable food producer in the world offers an opportunity through an enhanced brand image, if you like, to guarantee agricultural productivity and profitability for the long term whilst delivering better environmental outcomes for everyone. I particularly want to say a word about the state of the world's oceans and the parlous situation they face. The peoples of Aotearoa, New Zealand, have always been close to the sea. I mean, literally, of course, as no point in these islands is more than 80 miles from the coast, but also spiritually. Maori have long understood the importance of caring for and managing our precious marine resources, because the oceans are not just an essential treasure trove of biodiversity and a major source of food, they are also an increasingly important source of medicines, and vitally, they provide 70% of the oxygen that we breathe, as well as regulating our climate. Furthermore, the ocean floor is a carbon sink, as long as it isn't ploughed up regularly by deep trawling practices, as currently happens in many parts of the world. So we are utterly dependent on the oceans and their health for our own survival. We can no longer neglect, plunder, and degrade them, as we have for centuries, let alone expect our damaging agri-industrial, chemical, and artificial practices on land not to have a cumulatively damaging effect on marine ecosystems through runoff from the rivers. 97% of the ocean is open to fishing, with over 90% of the large fish gone, 64% of the stocks experiencing overfishing, and global fisheries heading towards collapse by 2048. When I should be 100 years old, if I survive, which is unlikely. Longline fisheries have also wrought havoc on many bird populations, including in New Zealand, which has the most diverse seabird community in the world, with vital breeding grounds for over 85 species of seabirds. Many of these, ladies and gentlemen, are now in serious peril, in particular the Antipodean albatross, which could become functionally extinct within 20 years unless urgent action is taken. In my capacity as patron of the Southern Seabird Solutions Trust, I can only ask whether we are really prepared, ladies and gentlemen, to see this happen on our watch, when there are already proven simple mitigation methods that can reduce albatross deaths by some 90%. Now, as most people are aware, we also face a crisis with ocean plastics. An estimated 13 million tons of plastic end up in our oceans every year, breaking down into microplastics that infiltrate marine food systems. Scientists estimate that there are over 150 million tons of plastics circulating in the marine environments. And if nothing changes, there will be a greater mass of plastic in the oceans by 2050 than there will of fish. Again, we have the solutions within our grasp. We are a long way from protecting the 10% of our ocean by 2020, mandated by Sustainable Development Goal 14. Indeed, only 2.7% of the ocean is fully protected. And yet recent studies demonstrate that with accurate and judicious protection of 30% of the ocean, the global catch would increase by 37%. Ladies and gentlemen, as they say, this is not rocket science. It is called working in harmony with nature or conservation by creating marine protected areas where fish can breed in safety. Above all, however, we need to shift our thinking and the outdated regulatory and financial models that constrain it to move towards a truly circular economy which liberates us from the damaging throwaway society we have built with its take, make, dispose approach. Instead, we can take less, make less, and dispose of less, massively reducing our impact on this planet, and at the same time generating value from things we have been short-sightedly discarding as waste. I must say, I have been particularly impressed by New Zealand's efforts in this regard, based on the principles of designing out waste and pollution, keeping products and materials in use, and restoring natural capital. Again, the solutions are there, including making the producer responsible for managing their own product waste, as happens in Sweden. And we simply must embrace them before we run out of rapidly diminishing time. On every pressing issue that we face, energy, transport, forests, there are solutions that are not just available, but are increasingly cost-effective. Critically, their success will be dependent upon us taking an integrated system-wide approach. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is where the real opportunity lies, because an integrated approach will provide the framework to unlock large-scale targeted investment, both from the public and private sectors. And in this way, we can move trillions of dollars away from the activities that are causing our planet most harm to those which can help it heal, working alongside, not against, nature in order to help her reverse all the damage we have done to her. With the consumers controlling over 60% of global GDP, we must remember that we have a choice in what we buy, and we should be diligent in exercising it, for it is perhaps the strongest signal we can send. The retail sector can play a significant role by embedding environmental indices into supply chain monitoring. Arguably, we all have a right to know whether the products we buy, clothing, cars, technology, food, have substantial environmental and social footprints, and to have access to alternatives if they do. While there continues to be much debate around the world on carbon pricing, it is increasingly clear that we should be factoring in the social and environmental impacts across the value chain. At the same time, we should be incentivizing sustainable goods, services, and behaviors, and disincentivizing those that are causing most harm. Surely we can no longer stand for the pollution of our waterways, the destruction of animal habitats, the poisoning of the air we breathe, or the exploitation of people for cheap labor. With greater transparency and availability of information on the sustainability of goods and services, consumers will be able to make more informed choices, which will in turn drive sustainable market trends. To do what I can to assist with this transition, and after nearly 40 years of trying to encourage corporate social and environmental responsibility, I recently launched a Sustainable Markets Council with the support of the World Economic Forum, specifically to build a coalition of industry and finance leaders with the vision and the ability to help transition the global economy towards sustainable markets and rapid decarbonization. For what it's worth, I have long believed that the private sector is absolutely critical if we are to deliver change at the pace and the scale we need. At the same time, it is a systems level transition that is required, and we must work across public, private, and philanthropic sectors to achieve it. A transition to sustainable markets has the potential to spark innovation, new industries, new employment opportunities, and economic growth, while at the same time offering social and planetary dividends. The financial system is changing too, and sustainable approaches to financing, such as natural capital pricing, blended finance, impact bonds, and climate financing, are starting to change the way people think about traditional financing models. As the private sector and capital markets finally begin to awaken to the sustainability movement, there are an increasing number of sustainable investment opportunities. Indeed, ladies and gentlemen, there are vast financial resources available in sovereign wealth funds, pension funds, the insurance sector, and asset portfolios, which can be mobilized in a way that drives real change, leveraging new technologies rapidly to decarbonize our global economy and help us move to a truly circular system. So through my Sustainable Markets Council, we are working to convene key industry leaders in sectors such as forestry and agroforestry, renewable energy, automotive, plastics alternatives, the bioeconomy, water and sanitation infrastructure, agriculture, and aviation, where, for instance, real possibilities exist for aircraft to be powered by second-generation biofuels, including from waste materials, blended with fossil fuels to reduce emissions as part of an eventual transition to carbon-free flight. The centralized nature of aviation fueling, with less than 5% of airports handling 90% of international flights, means that making sustainable aviation fuel available at a small number of airports could make a significant difference to the carbon intensity of the sector. So this is just one example of the need to focus on alternatives, identify barriers to action, and matchmake opportunities with the finance needed to bring them to scale. In parallel, we need to increase consumer awareness in a way that accelerates demand for sustainable goods and services. And if the perverse incentives that have been causing such widespread damage to the environment in sectors such as industrialized agriculture, fisheries, and fossil fuels could be redirected towards genuinely sustainable investment outcomes that restore and enhance natural ecosystems and biodiversity, we would stand a far better chance of righting the balance we have so disastrously upset. Nature-based solutions demonstrate that if we give space to nature, she has an extraordinary capacity to regenerate. Examples can be seen in protected regeneration areas, forest conservation, sand dunes, mangroves, seagrass and kelp beds, coral and shellfish reefs, wild farming and fisheries, restoration of peatlands and permanent grasslands. Nature-based approaches could also fuel a sustainable bioeconomy and create new income opportunities in areas such as ecotourism. so much innovation and development in sustainable technologies and alternatives, there must be a way rapidly to accelerate progress in the right direction. To do this, we need to find ways to match investment to investables, including nature, ensuring that investors see the opportunities that exist and that the structuring is in place to seize them. There are many fascinating and promising innovations currently undercapitalized, which could perhaps make such a substantial difference. Technologies such as, for instance, waste heat recovery systems that recycle industrial byproducts into value-added carbon-free energy sources. Plant-based plastic alternatives which could render traditional plastics obsolete. A type of charcoal made from biomass that can reduce the greenhouse gas emissions of coal-fired power plants. Energy storage innovations, such as peer-to-peer solar energy sharing systems. Transformational developments on carbon capture and storage and its conversion to fertilizer. Environmental monitoring technology, and I could go on and on. Now, of course, none of them represents a silver bullet, but taken together, could they help us fundamentally to change the trajectory? I believe they could, and I've asked my Sustainable Markets Council to look at how best to match and scale a whole range of such sustainable innovations for global application. The work I'm trying to do with this council is just one initiative amongst many others, but it might, I hope, help to accelerate the pace of progress. If we are to bring about a transformative change, we need to build a global movement for low carbon solutions, together with a global alliance of committed investors who see the increasingly valuable returns, socially, environmentally, and financially, from sustainable investment opportunities that will assist the rapid decarbonization, and it has to be rapid, of our planet's atmosphere and the sustainable markets to enable them. No lesser level of ambition will do. We simply must be bold, and we must make choices that are right for the future, not just convenient for today. We must think seven generations ahead and start thinking and acting in the interests of our grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and those that will follow them. For the past, 40 to 50 years, I have been driven by an overwhelming desire not to be confronted by my grandchildren, or yours, ladies and gentlemen, whom I mind about equally as much, demanding to know why I didn't do anything to prevent them being bequeathed a poisoned and destroyed planet. Now, of course, we are indeed being confronted by these very children, demanding immediate action and not just words. How much longer, therefore, can we dither and delay? The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report 2018 estimates that between 2016 and 2035, the annual cost of keeping the rise in temperature to 1.5 degrees centigrade would be about $2.4 trillion, or roughly 2.5% of global GDP. It's not very much, really. Such investments, however, have the potential to yield transformative returns. For not only would we address climate change, we would also have cities in which we could move and breathe, and ecosystems that are robust and fruitful. What better investment opportunity could there ever be? And really, at the end of the day, what is the point of all the wealth in the world if, ultimately, we destroy everything that makes this world worthwhile or habitable? Who can spend the money on? Ladies and gentlemen, we stand at the threshold of a global transformation. with the potential to secure a prosperous and sustainable future for us all. But can we cross that threshold quickly enough? That is the defining challenge of this most critical of times. So, I hope you will join me in this movement to build sustainable markets and transition to a decarbonized global economy. With ambition, creativity, and tenacity, the very essence of human endeavor, not only can we avert disaster, but the opportunities for prosperity are truly limitless. Tenakutu, tenakutu, tenatatu katoa.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join with me in thanking His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales for his address today. A lot of inspirational words there, and certainly addressing some of the great challenges that Aotearoa New Zealand and the global community faces. Thank you very much.